Well, let's welcome to Conversations in Health, Global to Local. This is our first guest lecture of the 2024 spring semester. So thanks everybody for coming. We have an incredible guest here tonight, and an old friend of mine. I guess we're fair enough. We can say we're old friends
we're old
now
friends.
At this point.
We're old.
Old, exactly. Patty Fugere spent many years, and she'll tell you more about her background, as the executive director of the Washington Legal Clinic for the Homeless. She built an organization really from scratch, though she'll say that she had lots of help, but the reality is when homelessness really emerged on the streets of Washington, D.C. in a very visible way in the 1980s, Patty was a leader in bringing legal services to help individuals who are homeless and families who are homeless advocate for themselves. And the reason why that matters in a health class is that housing is an incredibly important determinant of health. And it's most visible, the disruption of housing is an incredibly negative impact on health outcomes. And obviously there's lots of justice issues here. The last thing I'd say before we start a conversation is there are people you're gonna meet in life, and tonight is one of these opportunities for you, because I've known Patty for years, who managed, that we talked about last week, to have a true north, a sense of moral values, and an ability to align your professional life and how you conduct yourself when you're interacting with people, even when it's unpleasant. I can't think of anybody I've met in my life who embodies those values more than Patty. And so it's been fabulous to watch her do this work. And she'll tell you about how 1,000 other people helped her do the things that we're gonna talk about. But individual people matter. And so anyway, I just wanted to give you a sense of who our guest is tonight. And so as a reminder for people on the video, the way we work is Patty and I will take probably about 20 or 30 minutes to talk a little bit about her life. And then we'll turn it over to the students in the class. We're going to start with Ethan because he was kind enough to do a briefing email for the whole class. But then we'll turn it over to everybody and we'll just have a conversation. And it's a chance, as we discussed last week, for you to meet somebody who's a leader, meet somebody who has made a difference in their career. And maybe you might think it's unusual for a Conversations in Health class to start with a lawyer as our first speaker, mm-hmm. but not at all. Because law and advocacy is critical, especially for raising the voices and helping people use their voices, as Patty would remind me. I was hearing you in the back of my mind. People use their voices to advocate for what they need and what will, in effect, prove health outcomes. So thanks, everybody, for coming, and thanks, everybody, for joining us. So, Patty,
great.
Welcome.
Well, thank you for being so generous in your welcome and introduction. And
John, it's all fair.
Well, I'm not sure, but John is one of the many people whose hands were laboring to get this organization on stable footing, and he continues to support the work in multitude of ways. So thank you for that.
Well, thanks. Well, Patty, so this is a familiar place to you.
It is.
Because
it
you
is.
Went to college here.
I did.
But
I
before you, so where did you, before you came to the Hilltop?
Okay.
So tell us where you grew up and what got you interested in coming to Georgetown.
Sure. So I was born in Philadelphia. But grew up as a New Jersey girl, South Jersey. South Jersey, exit 4 of the turnpike. And had a wonderful suburban lifestyle, I guess. And parents who really emphasized the importance of integrating faith into our lives and recognized that doing service was an important element of living our faith. And so I feel like that's either in my DNA or it was very much in the air that I breathed growing up. So
right.
It's both nature and nurture for me. And I had a lot of opportunities to volunteer when I was young and had the support of my parents in doing that. And what landed me here at Georgetown, honestly, was I had an older brother who I revered who came to Georgetown.
Gotcha.
And I had some thought that I might be interested in government and politics, and like, what better place to be than Washington? So
And when, and just before we jump to Georgetown, when you were doing, you grew up in a Catholic family, a Catholic community.
Yes.
And did you go to Catholic schools?
I did.
And did you do service work around housing and homelessness when you were, before you got here, or was that something that you started
that
when you
was,
came to D.C.?
It was really when I came to D.C., I mean, with that kind of a focus.
Gotcha. Mm-hmm. So let's bring us up to the hilltop. So everybody here at the table here shares this experience that we all did.
Yeah.
Except for Oliver, sorry. But tell me a little bit about your time here, because this is really when you first started to get involved with homeless issues in the D.C. area.
So because of having the experience of integrating volunteering into my life when I got to Georgetown, I started immediately to look for volunteer opportunities. And one of the things I got involved with, and the place doesn't exist any longer, which is a complicated political story to tell, but I got involved in Sursum Corda tutoring. And at the time, I believe it was coordinated by someone you may all know, whose name is John DeGioia. And he was a great leader of volunteering back in the 70s. So for Sursum Corda tutoring, we jumped in a big old blue van, got driven down to a housing complex that was off of North Capitol Street.
So, do you all know where Sursum Corda is, or even what it's about? Why don't you want to take a sentence because it's important.
Well, yeah. So Sursum Corda was a complex of apartments that was established by a wonderful Jesuit priest named Horace McKenna. Sursum Corda means lift up our hearts. And he was, I think, based at St. Aloysius Parish down on North Capitol Street where Gonzaga High School is. And he recognized the need for housing for the low-income community members in their neighborhood. And so he worked with the people he knew and was able to gather the resources together to, you know, provide this opportunity for housing to be developed for low-income residents. And I guess because of the Jesuit connection, Georgetown took on some volunteering work, and we signed up as tutors, and we were matched with a particular family, and we would jump on the van every week and, you know, drive out of the walled Georgetown compound and through the city and into this rather dark and neglected area of town, and get involved with family life with these kids and help them with their homework and help them to understand, you know, whether it's math or reading or whatever their challenges might be. And we were there for an hour and a half, and it was fascinating. You know, as the bus pulls or the van pulls in, the kids are swarming like little mice running out, you know, and they were so excited to have the help of the Georgetown students. But one of the things that struck me very early on was that we had this experience, we would jump back on the van, we pulled out and turned south onto North Capitol Street, which means that we were looking at about a mile down the road at the beautifully lit up dome of the US Capitol. And between that, you know, that 1 mile destination down the road and the place that we just left, there was a chasm of thousands of miles and tremendous misunderstanding and neglect and disregard, and it made no sense at all to me that we could have both of those worlds so proximate to one another. And I think that sort of lit the fire for me that I wanted to do something with the gift that my family provided me of having this great education from Georgetown. And to figure out ways, like, what are my gifts and skills and talents? I mean, I was 18 years old. What did I know about anything? But it kind of inspired me to think about my time at Georgetown as a journey to figure out what I could do to sort of make that chasm a little bit smaller and safer to cross.
And so when you did the tutoring when you were an undergrad, mm-hmm. and when did you start to get involved in the homelessness work, mm-hmm. and And I can't remember when where Mitch Snyder fits into the sequence here, but is it later? Okay.
I knew of Mitch. Mitch Snyder was the main homeless activist in Washington, really across the country, back in the 1980s. He was, I think his background was in marketing, and he was jailed for credit card fraud. And one of his cellmates, or two of his cellmates, were the Berrigan brothers. And I don't know if any of you know who Daniel and Philip Berrigan are, but really extraordinary peace activists and
Jesuit priests.
One stayed, one did not. But they lit the fire for Mitch, and they helped to found a community called the Community for Creative Nonviolence, which at the time in the 1970s was an anti-war, anti-Vietnam War collective of hippies and anarchists and peace activists. And Mitch got involved in CCNV, and he was its leader for quite a long while. And he had a particular skill or gift for making people feel uncomfortable, who were settling into too much comfort in their lives. So he was a great person to prick the conscience of the powers that be in many places. And he was a very strong voice on a national level, but also here locally. And one of the voices that he always, powers that he tried to remind of its obligations with regard to justice was the Catholic Church. And the Holy Trinity in the late 1970s, maybe 78, was undergoing a renovation, probably hundreds of thousands of dollars of renovation of an organ or something like that, I don't know. But it wouldn't open its doors to people who were unhoused in the wintertime. And Mitch just saw that as an egregious mistake and began a series of protests, silent protests at Holy Trinity, where he and other members of CCNV would go into the church and stand during service and turn their backs to the altar as a just a reminder that there was a problem with the way they were doing their business. And that was the kind of person that Mitch was. And he was able to turn a lot of hearts from stone into pure welcome and concern. He also ticked off a lot of people too in the process. He was very controversial. You loved Mitch or you really disliked Mitch. But to his credit, he was instrumental in having the passage of what remains the main federal law that governs any provision of homeless services from a national perspective, the McKinney-Vento laws. And Mitch nearly died in the process because he was doing campouts on the Capitol grounds in the wintertime and caught pneumonia, I think. And Stuart McKinney actually was the congressman who sponsored the legislation. He did die of pneumonia.
He did, right?
Yeah. So Mitch fit in a way when I was an undergrad. Right. I kind of got a sense of what the community was and what was going on there. And can I just, I think
no,
you also, so
yeah.
the way I got connected to the housing and homelessness piece was also through some volunteer work that I had done. And as a rising junior here, I got involved volunteering as a volunteer tenant organizer with a small nonprofit organization in DC, helping to organize low-income tenants to purchase their homes under a particular DC law that gave the tenants the first right to have an opportunity to buy a property if a landlord wanted to sell it. And we did some organizing in the area that is now the very very different neighborhood than it was in 1979, Columbia Heights. So that was the sort of my entry into the world of housing. And I got bit by the housing bug, and I knew that was something that I wanted to stay involved with, but I didn't know how. And so I took the LSAT exam, and I took the GRE exam, and wanted to keep my options open, and I guess I kind of flubbed the GRE or something. I don't remember a particular decisive moment, but I did decide that law school was a path for me, not because I desperately wanted to be a lawyer, but because I knew that would give me some tools to further the interests of clients around housing justice issues.
And so when you went to law school, so that makes sense, absolutely, and your work follows from that, but how was law school? Was it a good experience, or was it just something you felt you needed to get through to get back to doing the work that you wanted to do in the community?
Well, I will say that Georgetown Law School of 1981 was very different than Georgetown Law School now. I love Georgetown Law School. I absolutely love it. I love its leadership. I think the dean is, you know, amazing, and I love the faculty, and I love the students, and I love teaching there. I get the joy of teaching there every couple of years. But I think to Dean Traynor's credit, he has really infused it with a very active interpretation of sort of Jesuit ideals and men and women for and with others. And it wasn't quite that way back in the 1980s. But it was an experience that you could make of it what you wished. And I sought out the one clinic that was available that focused on housing. And I sought out volunteer opportunities. And when I was in my second year, I think, a friend of mine from undergrad had been tapped to open a women's shelter and asked me if I would be interested in volunteering. So every Tuesday night, I would wait till the library closed and jump on the D2 bus to go up East Street and run through the neighborhood that's now the, you know, Chinatown Gallery Place area that was very desolate and abandoned back then, but go to the Calvary Church where they turned their social activity space into an emergency shelter for homeless women. So that was sort of my introduction to homelessness in DC. And we were all just kind of stumbling blind through this world of homelessness. It was kind of a new phenomenon.
I was going to ask you about that. Because it really did expand. I mean, in terms of public consciousness, for sure.
Sure.
It grew, and the visibility of people mm-hmm. on the street after the deinstitutionalization yeah. and some of the yeah. changes in the city.
Yeah. I mean, I think I talk about three primary factors that are sort of there with a foundation of racism underneath the three of them. But there were dramatic cuts in federal funding for affordable housing during the Reagan administration, yeah. which made a significant, had a significant impact on low-income Americans. There was deinstitutionalization, which was the move to get people who were struggling with mental health issues out of the institutions that were not at the time providing appropriate care, where they didn't need to be, and to get them back into community, into the least restrictive environment that they could be in, which is a noble goal. But what seemed to happen not only in DC but elsewhere was that hospitals were great at putting people out. Cities were terrible about putting in place the community supports and resources that they needed mm-hmm. to maintain their health in the community. So folks were losing contact with their families, or relationships were breaking, and that also led to homelessness. And for the district in particular, in the early 1980s, we were in the throes of a very significant crack cocaine epidemic. Yeah. And along with that, the incarceration of significant numbers of young black men. And that also led to broken families and people losing support systems. And I think you can see, without my drawing too many lines, you know, how racism was at play in each of those things. And I think that was sort of the perfect storm of what led to modern day homelessness here in the District of Columbia.
And so you gotta, so if you went, so you, so given that environment in the community, which was very, and I do remember this very well from, it's hard to imagine now, but homelessness really was not, I mean, there are obviously always people who are unhoused in this city, and but it was not a public discussion in any meaningful way before the early to mid-80s.
Right.
So now you're a lawyer, you've got your degree, you're out in the world.
I am.
How did you get from there to the clinic?
Okay. Well, one of the first things I did when I got out of law school, and I had the incredible, I've had so many blessings in my life that I don't deserve, but I had the amazing blessing of working with three of the preeminent housing attorneys in the country, one from a legal service perspective, one from a policy perspective, and one who focused on rural housing issues. So I grew up at the knee of the greats, and they gave me opportunities to get involved in a lot of pro bono work and really find my niche in terms of where I belonged in the housing spectrum. And one of the first things that I did was to get involved with a shelter for survivors of domestic violence and set up a little legal clinic at my sister's place shelter in DC, helping where Susie Hoffman worked. Yeah. Helping women who had the courage to leave what became an untenable situation to get civil protective orders and to help them meet other potential legal needs. So that got me into thinking about the model of lawyers in shelters. But then I heard about this group that was coming together under the sponsorship of the DC Bar, and it was the DC Bar Ad Hoc Committee on the Homeless, and there was a...
And the DC Bar, so the Bar Association is the local organization of registered attorneys here in DC. I'm sorry.
Yeah, no, thank you. And one of the lawyers who happened to be an immigration lawyer, but he chaired the immigration section, nothing to do with homelessness, except every day when he would run to work, he passed an increasing number of people sleeping on the streets, and he thought, what the heck, you know, we got to be able to do something about this. So he used the bully pulpit he had as head of the immigration committee of the bar to send out a call to action, like, anybody who's interested in figuring out what can lawyers do to help people who are homeless, let's get together and use our brain power to do that. So I thought, yeah, this is me. So I got involved in that group of people, and we did something that lawyers are not always known to do, which is to acknowledge that we didn't know the answer to the question, how can lawyers be helpful? So we went out into the community to talk to folks who were very directly involved, in serving people or homeless folks, like Marianne Luby, who ran a women's day center, or folks who were, you know, running soup kitchens, people like Mitch Snyder, right? And so we talked about a lot of different things, and then eventually honed in on the thought that people who were in shelters, or not even in shelters, people sleeping rough on the streets, did have issues where lawyers could be helpful, but they weren't able to access even a legal services lawyer through some of the traditional mechanisms of connecting with a lawyer. There were free lawyers available, but the supply was pretty limited, and there were barriers to folks being able to do that, either logistical barriers, you know, not having bus fare to get downtown to an office, or psychological barriers of not really trusting the system, because it was the system that led them to their homelessness, right? So we thought, well, what about if we devise a program to overcome both sets of barriers? Let's go out into the community, be with clients in their comfort zone, in their spaces, and be there with the stamp of approval of people who those community members have come to trust, so that if we were there at, you know, Mitch's request or with Mary Ann's blessing, then we must be okay, and it's a good thing to go and talk to the lawyers. They're not out to get us or, you know, whatever, trip us up in any way. And that was the very humble beginning of what eventually became the Legal Clinic for the Homeless. And at the same time, I was also working closely with Mitch to set up a program right at the CCNV shelter where John volunteered as a young lawyer. And that was originally outside the purview of the Legal Clinic, but eventually it all came together. Yeah.
And then Patty, by the time, so in the starting from those humble beginnings, when you retired last year as executive director, can you give us a sense of scale of the clinic now?
As of a year ago.
Okay.
but we had, I think, 14 or 15 staff members. We've had, over the years, we've had hundreds, probably thousands of attorneys volunteering their time. We were, probably a little bit over $2 million budget, I think. And we were not solely a direct service clinic for people who are homeless. Should I talk about that evolution?
Absolutely. Okay. No, I'm sorry. I was just hinting at getting into that.
Okay. All righty. Great. So we started out doing, you know, the direct service piece. I don't know if you're familiar with the Peanuts cartoon where Lucy has the little booth where it says the psychiatrist is in, right? So we kind of set up our little desk, you know, the lawyer is in, what can we do to help you? And we did that in a number of different locations, shelters, day centers, dining programs, community centers, places that met our criteria of being convenient to the client and, you know, comfortable place for them to be. And we learned pretty quickly that our client, hopefully we knew this going in, but it affirmed that it wasn't our clients who were broken. It was the systems that were set up to serve them that were broken. And I think those broken systems often cast the blame back on the people that they failed, so that so many of our clients did sort of feel their brokenness. And I think a big part of what we were able to do was to move them past that, you know, to show them, you know, they are worthy of their rights being honored. They are worthy of support. So when we think about the broken systems, we can help individual clients maneuver through those systems. We can help client after client after client get food stamps or SNAP benefits that they were denied because of a glitch or because somebody processed the application wrong, whatever. We could do that. We needed to do that because a family was going to go hungry if we didn't. But we also needed to figure out, where is that system problem? You know, it's the tale of you're standing on the shore and you see all these babies floating down the river, and you pull the babies out because you need to, and then you think, I can't keep doing one at a time, so you throw a net across, and then you catch babies, you know, all together, and then you think, who's throwing them in? Like, why are they floating down the river, and what can we do to stop? So we swam upstream to figure out who was throwing our clients into this abyss of homelessness, and figured out ways that we could challenge those broken systems and repair them, compel the government to repair them, to, you know, come into compliance with the laws and to actually meet their mission and their mandate to serve. So we were getting a lot of victories in the courtroom that were then being undone by policy decisions or budgetary decisions that were being made by local officials, both on the executive side of our government and on the council side of the government. So that was a big signal to us that we needed to at least get one foot out of the courtroom and into our city hall, which is the Wilson Building, and make sure that our clients' interests were represented in the conversations that were impacting their lives, the policy conversations and the conversations to set a budget for how the District of Columbia money was going to be spent. And we learned in that process quite early on that the best spokespeople in those situations was people who are directly impacted. So, excuse me, again, kind of counter to what we're taught as lawyers, we tried to get out of the way of our clients and not speak for them, but support them and provide the tools that they needed to speak for themselves and to tell their stories directly.
And what kind of issues did you work on? And did you work only as the legal clinic, or did you work in coalition with others?
So we covered a pretty broad range of issues at the clinic. My own personal portfolio, it's so silly. But my interest was housing, public housing in particular, was my thing. And I was very hands-on involved in a lawsuit that put the DC Housing Authority, which is one of the worst in the country, into a court-overseen receivership. So it means the court took it over because it was failing so abysmally in following the law and meeting its mandates. And the court appointed an expert to come in as receiver and turn the agency around, which he did in kind of a record 5 years. It went to being a high-performing agency, and then it's been this very slow fall back into great disarray, unfortunately, to my personal pain. But so we did housing. We did a lot in public housing. We did public benefits, public assistance for people who had disabilities, the old-fashioned welfare programs, TANF, as it's called now, food stamps or SNAP, mental health issues for a long time. So it really kind of ran the gamut, and it's like anything really was fair game if it touched the life of our clients. And we had the good fortune to have some good relationships with other providers in the community. So we did a lot of our work in coalition, because it was important that as the District of Columbia, which at the time was on the brink of bankruptcy and being taken over by Congress, which we could drop a footnote on that in just a moment, the decision makers had to deal with this, you know, horrible financial situation that they were in by cutting back budgets. And we knew they were going to do that at the expense of our community, right? And they would pit one population against another. You want money for shelters, we're going to take it out of home health aids. Or you want money in the mental health system, well, we're going to have to cut the child care budget. And we, like, no, that's not acceptable. That's not the way these kinds of decisions ought to be made, because you're hurting the very same people or the very same families. And so back in 1994, 30 years?
It is. It's okay.
So 30 years ago, we sent out an invitation to every organization that we knew to come together to figure out how do we make sure that our client community, the collective low-income community in DC, is not the sole target of these budget-cutting decisions that needed to be made. And until then, it seemed, at least, that the only times nonprofit organizations would advocate was around their own budgets. Like, if it impacted their contract with the city, you know, they were gonna, they would go down to the Wilson Building and have all their, you know, their members or guests, whatever, you know, in matching T-shirts, so they could see that, you know, how many people that supported XYZ program were there. And they would tell stories about how great their work was, which was important. We needed those services to be provided. But beyond that, there was not a presence of the impacted community, and there was not any volume to the voices of those in the nonprofit world to talk about the impact on the people, not just on the programs, but on the people. And this gathering that we helped to pull together eventually became what's called the Fair Budget Coalition, which 30 years later still exists and is quite effective, I think, in making sure that community members' interests are represented in the budget and policy conversations. And I, Oliver, I was particularly interested when you talked about looking at leadership. And you know, I think probably if you, how many of us are in the room, we would have this many different definitions of what leadership is and who the real leaders in our community are. And we have, at the Legal Clinic, I think, have really tried to make sure that the leadership is of those who are directly impacted. And I know, at least while I was at the clinic, you know, we still had a long way to go to do that as well as it needed to be done. But I think, you know, we were pretty consistent in embracing that as a value, mm-hmm. and really tried to make sure that our clients had the support that they needed to be there, the leaders in their efforts.
And that's when I misspoke earlier and I said that the Legal Clinic spoke for the clients. I always have Patty in the back of my mind reminding that the role of a lawyer, and this is actually what the role of a lawyer should be, is to support your client in expressing herself or himself in what they need and what they want. And just so for everyone to know, the legacy of Patty's work to create the Fair Budget Coalition was one of your readings for today. So one thing you do have as part of your time with us here is you're a resident now, even a part-time, of the District of Columbia. So you've got a stake in the decisions that our government makes.
Absolutely.
And so one of the things I did want you to take away from this is that the Fair Budget Coalition's legislative agenda, that's its agenda for low-income people in the District of Columbia.
Yes, and it is formulated with significant input by community members. That is a vital piece of how the coalition develops its agenda. And that has always been important to us at the Legal Clinic. As I say, we didn't perfect it by any means, but you know, we at least knew we wanted to be on that path. And you know, there are different ways that you can get community input. You know, you can, as the clinic did, we had impacted community members on our board, still does, and people on our staff who have experienced poverty and homelessness, and through our client work, our direct client work. You know, when you see thousands of clients every year and they bring to you their particular issue, then you know this is a priority for this person. They have a lot of other things going on in their life, like trying to get housing, but it was so important to them to address X issue that they came to talk to the lawyer. So we know that there are people who are concerned about that kind of thing as well. So there are different ways to get that input, but it's something that's really vital, I think, in helping to set the agenda.
I'm going to ask one more question before I turn it over to our students, but it's to kind of bring us up to the current moment and ask you to reflect on some of the debates around homelessness. I'll just say a couple of thoughts, and you can feel free to disagree with me, but as hard as the 80s were and the emerging of a visible homeless population in the city, there was a debate that was driven more about either this shouldn't be happening or some sympathy or an effort to evoke sympathy that something's not working, that something's wrong. And I fear that we've moved to a debate now where homeless people are seen as the problem themselves. And I think that's not entirely unrelated to this constant debate about housing first versus treatment first, which is do we have, quote, broken people or people that need to get some aspect of their lives, either their mental health or their substance abuse or other issues, sorted before they can move to permanent housing? Or do we take the view, and you all read, you know, the about this as part of your preparation. So, Patty, I'd love your reflection on the politics of whether the face of homelessness is changing and in what direction, and also your thought about this debate, which I think is going to be a national debate. I think homeless issues have raised to the national level, but not necessarily in a productive way.
I cannot disagree with you on that. I certainly have been witness to many changes over the years. And one of the things that I have seen is that even within the homeless community, there is a hierarchy of people who are experiencing homelessness, right? So for some reason, this city has decided that immigrants who were victimized by leaders, you know, I won't call them leaders, I will call them elected officials, they're not leaders, but people who were transported and dumped in the District of Columbia who were homeless, there were decisions made that that group of people was going to be treated differently than somebody who was homeless previously in the District of Columbia. And then there was a time, and I don't know if you remember this, John, but after Katrina, there was a pretty large contingent of residents from the New Orleans area who were evacuated up to D.C.
Katrina, for the...
Oh, my gosh.
It's Hurricane Katrina.
Yeah, sorry.
That impacted New Orleans and the southern part of the United States. Devastating impact in 2005.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
I always have to remember it. You guys probably don't remember that. I would be shocked.
But there was a big group of people that came up to this area, and we had heard that people were offered a flight to Dulles Airport out in suburban, you know, D.C., and folks thought they were being offered a flight to Dallas, Texas, which was not all that far away from New Orleans. And people ended up here who had no contacts, no nothing, right? And the city opened up the Armory building as a shelter. The outpouring of support for that group of people was beyond anything you could imagine. You had people who owned apartment buildings, you had hairdressers and barbers and babysitters and, you know, mom's clubs that were donating diapers and this and that and everything, right? Because these people were victims of this natural disaster. They were not seen as responsible for their plight. As opposed to our clients who at the time were being sheltered in the most remote corner of the District of Columbia, multiple families to a room, and parents couldn't get a pack of diapers from the shelter provider if, you know, they turned themselves inside out to do it, because those people were blamed for their situation. And I think we see that kind of blaming the victim continue on in decisions that have been made in the current, you know, administration about what shelter is going to look like. When the city decided, and this was the right decision, to close down the big family shelter in the old public hospital, and they built smaller, more humane facilities around the city, the decision was made not to make them too comfortable, because people will become lazy and they will not try to do better for their families. And so we have that still, that very negative feeling about people living with the challenges of poverty. And it does feel like the collective heart has hardened to a point where, you know, at least in officialdom around here, you know, decisions are being made by folks who don't have the sort of respect for and regard for the people that the legal clinic serves that one would hope would have a compassionate heart. I don't know if that answered your question.
No, it's an excellent answer. And I thought, no, because I wanted to bring us to today, because this is not a historical discussion of homelessness. Right. This is a very real, live public issue in our city, Yeah. And dare say, I think the presidential election that we're about to experience is going to raise homelessness from being categorized more typically as a local issue to more of a national one.
Yeah. You know, you had mentioned the housing first debate. So housing first versus housing ready, which we always kind of call it housing worthy. You know, that because it's that same thing where somebody is making a judgment about whether someone deserves to be housed. How do we get to that point in life that there is any human being who was deemed unworthy to be housed? But that's where some of these decisions come from, that, you know, you don't move along this continuum until you have complied with the rules that I have set, that I think you know, to be the kind of person that I want you to be before you move into housing.
So the counter argument, as you know, because we've heard this over the years, is that a little bit of tough love is what people need. Clearly, they're if you see it through the vision that their lives have failed, that's why they've ended up, then you need something to shock people. And I guess, well, thought about how you respond, and then I'm going to turn it over to Ethan.
Okay. So I will respond to that and say, you know, when you have conflict like that, this is a Marianne Luby thing. Our North Star has to be our clients. So let's go to the community members and see what works for them, which we did. You know, back in the beginning of, you know, an administration 20 years ago, we did a pretty broad community survey around housing first. We didn't put labels on it, like, you know, those kinds of names, but we asked people what kind of environment would help them to regain stability for themselves and their family. And most people, not all, most people felt that, like, regular housing would be really helpful, right? Housing that they could afford. But there were some people who felt, I'm struggling, I'm in recovery, I need to be in a place where there are people who understand my struggle and not have, you know, the crack cocaine being dealt out of an apartment down the hallway. You know, so there are people for whom a housing-ready program is something that is vitally important. But as we've seen, even those sorts of programs implemented, sometimes they are done in such a paternalistic way that it really does undercut the agency of the people that the organization is committed to serve. And how do you, if you're all about wanting to make somebody be independent, how will they ever be able to make decisions for themselves when every single decision is being made by these onerous house rules that a resident has to comply with? It doesn't set somebody up for success, I don't think, to graduate out of that kind of a program.
So I'm going to turn us over now to our students in the class and start with Ethan, who set us up for tonight. So Ethan, do you want to take the first question, then we'll go around the room.
Definitely. And thank you again for your time tonight. It's been great listening to your history and your career and everything that goes into that. So thank you again. Just wanted to ask, you know, from the advocacy perspective, because you ran the legal clinic, what approach do you mostly use for change? Is it more of a community expense perspective, such as, you know, an enhanced, you know, housing first program would reduce emergency room visits, and that would be more beneficial for the community? Or would you more so approach it from an individual perspective, where you're saying that value the health and the benefit of the individual?
Yes. Now, it really is a both end. And that's part of being a strategic advocate, is to figure out who are you trying to convince at any one particular time. I'm going to give you a really, really consolidated version of the law school seminar that I teach, right? So you have an advocacy goal, which hopefully has been set with the input of your clients. And then you have to figure out who has the power to make that goal achievable, and how do you impact and influence that point of power, and who are the right, what is the right message? Because we have 13 council members that at least 7 of whom have to be persuaded of your ask, and probably there are 7 different sets of things that you know, are impactful to the various council members. So, you know, for somebody who's really focused on the financial side of things, yeah, you dig deep and you figure out, like, this is the cost per year of a housing voucher, and this is the cost per year of, you know, shelter or hospitalization or incarceration. But for another council member, it may be that the individual stories are what is really impactful. And you work with your clients to help them figure out the best and most comfortable way to tell their stories to the powers that be. So you really have to do that kind of a deeper dive and think about, you know, like you say, who you're trying to influence and how you can be most effective and who the right voices are to impact that person. And it's often the clients, and sometimes, honestly, sometimes it's not. Sometimes it's, you know, business people. Like, we've had some strange partnerships over the years. I worked really closely with the downtown bid director when the city was about to cut the shelter budget, and hundreds of homeless men were on the verge of being, you know, sent out to the streets with no overnight shelter, and the downtown business improvement district didn't want to see, you know, 500 homeless guys hanging out on the streets downtown. And it was to their constituency's interest to keep shelters open. So we got business people to write letters and op-eds and things like that. So think about who your right messenger is, too, for any particular audience.
Well, anybody who's, should I go around? I could go around, whatever. Anyone want to go next? Questions? Oh, please.
I was really interested in your discussion of hierarchy among homeless individuals, mm-hmm. and something that I think was a bit of a recurring theme was that drug user abuse and also mental health issues often fall on the side that people tend to blame or consider those individuals responsible for their own plight, I think are the words you used.
Yeah.
I wondered what you think in terms of decriminalization movements as well as working to reduce mental health stigma, mm-hmm. and whether those movements can be beneficial to help reduce that.
I absolutely think they can be very helpful. We had done a lot of work in the mental health arena years ago when we had an outreach worker who was very tied into that community, and she spent a lot of time trying to open doors and open hearts to really making that connection with folks. You know, one of the things that I have learned over the years is, you know, the importance of that direct connect, right? That when you sit down face to face with someone who has been in a struggle, and it can really open your heart, right? In ways that when you read statistics and data, and some people will do the statistics, but you know, for a lot of people, it really is making that direct connection. So trying to find opportunities for people to be in relationship or at least in conversation, I think is really important. I think on the mental health side, some of the challenges, I would actually, I'm trying to think of the right way to frame this. I you know, in the hierarchy, you know, mental health is not as close to the bottom as, say, drug use might be, or people coming out of incarceration, because to a great degree, mental health is, there's a stigma around it, but it really is not as blames worthy in a sense, I guess. And please forgive me.
No, just take your time.
Thank you.
It is warm.
But the criminalization issue is a really important issue right now, and we have actually found some success. And I think it's because people were realizing, say with a, regarding, and it's hard to separate drug use and criminalization, right? There's a lot of connection there. Not saying that it's an, you know, an absolute fit, but when people started to realize that there were folks in their family or folks who lived down the street, like it wasn't a, it was no longer an us and a they. I'm sorry, I'm kind of going in a little bit of a circle to answer you, but when we other people, it makes it really easy to turn your backs on somebody. When we can, when we realize that they are not other, you know, we are them, they are us, because we all have family members who've been impacted by the opioid crisis, right? Or impacted by health concerns and mental health concerns. I think that ending that othering is really important in making progress on that front. And it's kind of crazy, but we've had a lot of, we had a lot of success in some of the efforts to open up the door to people returning from community. We were able to get the business community to support like the ban the box legislation, which means that you can't ask a question on either an employment application or a housing application about whether somebody has a criminal history until you get to the point where you've made a decision to offer them employment or offer an apartment. And you can ask about certain things, but you can't ask about other things. And you would think that the business community would be extremely opposed to that, but we were able to get support. And I think it's because folks were recognizing that it wasn't always other. They, you know, their lives were being touched by the same sorts of things.
Questions? Okay, that's Isabel.
Yeah, sure.
I was curious, you made it very clear early on that you guys all kind of always knew that one of the underlying factors was racism and all that. So I'm just curious, in what sort of legal but also social ways you went about addressing that?
That's a big question. Yeah. I would say one of the primary things that we did was, and I will be honest and confess, it took me a while to get comfortable with this. I had staff members, my colleagues were much more comfortable than I at first, but really calling it out and naming that when, you know, you are making decisions that families can't have individual bathrooms in their shelter unit because you think they'll be too comfortable and not be willing to get motivated to move out of shelter, and 99.9% of the families in the shelter system are Black, you can't take race out of that. And so calling that out, I think, was a really critical piece of the way we tried to address it. And, you know, nobody likes to be called out on being a racist, right? So it sometimes backfires and people shut down to any further conversation about that. But not letting people get off the hook when you see that there is some implication of race in the decisions that are being made. It's hard. It's a hard one, for sure.
Hannah?
Yeah. So homelessness is definitely a problem, not just in DC, but around the country. So I was wondering, have you worked with legal clinics or other organizations in other cities, either to sort of share your expertise or learn from them, and sort of what that relationship is like in the collaboration?
Yes, we have. Early on, we helped, sort of, we were one of the first, we weren't the first, but we were one of the early programs. So we, you know, we talked to a lot of other folks from around the country who were setting up programs and sent materials and provided samples and told our stories. And, you know, there's so many mistakes that one can make. You know, let's try to keep people from making mistakes that we've already made and learn from by telling them about, you know, the various traps that are out there. And then the ABA, the American Bar Association, was able to set up a commission on homelessness, and we helped contribute to their body of work. And then there are some national organizations, for example, the National Homeless Law Center, whose now director was at one time an attorney with the legal clinic. We have worked closely with her over the years. She ran a program in Baltimore, at the Baltimore version of the legal clinic in DC. And, we were often on the phone talking about, what their agenda was and what ours was and how we could learn from one another. So there is a good network. And I know Antonia at the National Homeless Law Center was setting up a forum where leaders from programs from around the country could come together and share ideas. And I think that was in a very nascent stage, but it's certainly something on her mind about ways that we can, network and learn from what's going on with other folks. And I'm doing a little bit of it now on my own.
I was going to say, in
my
current
retirement, from the legal clinic.
Consulting role.
My consulting role. I volunteer some time to a few different programs around the country. One of them is a program that serves unhoused neighbors out in San Jose that I learned about because its director was a childhood friend of my son's. And he's running a great program, and we talk every couple weeks, and I tell him about, challenges that I faced that, maybe are coming down the pike for him and things to think about in addressing those challenges. And I'm on the board of a wonderful program down in Florida called Community Spring, which is very different from the legal clinic, but really is focused on creating opportunity and supporting voice of impacted community members. And that was founded by another former attorney of the legal clinic, and being involved in that program has been great. So even now in an informal way, trying to make those connections and help programs learn from one another.
Leo and then Kayla.
Good. So thank you so much for coming today. I'm involved with a community service organization on campus, and we go out to the city and do some homeless outreach as well. One of the things that struck me as a global health student is how many of our homeless neighbors have chronic recurring health issues that they aren't able to manage very well without housing. And a lot of these folks, they end up in the hospital when the symptoms get bad enough that they have no one called on them. They're in the hospital for a bit, they use Zantala, and then they have no way to pay, no way to stay. They get put back onto the street, and they have no way to keep up with their medication. There's all these chronic recurring health issues that just snowball. And so how has the Washington legal clinic helped folks at that intersection, and how can the public health world better help the homeless with these chronic?
So one of the silver linings of the pandemic was that, or is that, people finally learned that having a big room with a whole bunch of bunk beds and 3 feet in between them, is a really bad way to provide shelter, right? Because during the pandemic, the city, decongregated some of the congregate shelters. I don't know if that's a word, if I made that up, but they lessened the census within various of the shelters to provide more space so there could be a little bit more social distancing. Still a really bad idea to have a whole bunch of people in one big room when you have a pandemic, but they had a smaller number of people there, which was a good thing. But they also set up a program that got the most vulnerable people out of those shelters altogether and into private hotel rooms. Yeah. And eventually the private rooms became, one roommate kind of rooms. But it was that called PEPV, the Pandemic Emergency Program for Vulnerable Individuals, I think was the term. And it was hugely successful in bringing numbers of infections down. You know, we used to track, one of our lawyers would track the infection data, and folks who were, you know, in shelter, it was one of the highest, you know, numbers across the board in the city. But having a resource like PEPV, where there was some element of privacy and space provided, it was really vital. But as federal money to support PEPV dried up, the city rolled back its investment in that kind of program. The clinic was very active in advocating that PEPV be expanded and adopted as a model for how to better shelter individuals. And there is still in the works in Ward 2, the Aston,
yeah, I think it's still.
That was a dorm, an apartment dorm for GW students that the city bought and was going to open up to provide shelter, you know, in sort of an individualized setting. And it's tied up in a lot of political stuff right now, unfortunately. But I think the answers are there. Like, we know what to do to minimize the risk and provide, you know, an environment where somebody can keep a medication that has to be refrigerated. You know, when you can't do that, when you're in this gigantic shelter that doesn't afford you that kind of access to some of the very basic things that somebody with chronic health concerns would need. Yeah.
Kayla?
My question is about your experience with advocacy work more broadly, because I think a lot of folks are drawn to advocacy work because there's this opportunity for major triumphs. You mentioned the courtroom wins that you've had.
Yeah.
But also, I've had a lot of friends and colleagues that have become very discouraged by advocacy work because the losses can feel very personal and very devastating when they do come. So I was wondering if there have been any of those losses for you in your career and how you managed to maintain hope and overcome them over all of these decades of work in a very important issue area that can be challenging to change the status quo.
Yes, there have been a number of losses and some of them are not so much like it was one bad decision that was made, but a gradual loss. I mentioned the Public Housing Authority.
Yeah.
I used to talk about that as one of the golden moments of my life as a lawyer, that we were able to turn this agency around, and then to see where it has backslid to is kind of devastating. But where I find the hope is in the people. Yeah, it's that, you know, the folks who are living in these terrible conditions, who still are able to fight to make things better, maybe not even for them any longer, but for their neighbors or their children. There is a hopefulness that I have been blessed to have the opportunity to see amongst the community members who are directly impacted. And because of that hopefulness and the energy that people continue to put into their efforts for their community, I feel it's such a privilege to continue to journey with them that you can't give up. One of the things that, and the groups of people that I really miss, and I didn't have a chance to do a lot of direct client work in my role at the legal clinic, but I did get to work with community members in doing some advocacy work. And there was a couple really wonderful groups of unhoused and formerly unhoused community members who came together to do advocacy. And one of them is the People for Fairness Coalition. And I have such immense regard for those folks, and I really miss, you know, working with them more closely. They are the group when it started it was primarily a group of men, most of whom eventually got into housing. But they were down at the Wilson Building or City Hall advocating that the family shelter budget not get cut. You know, nothing that would impact them directly, but it was an injustice. And they felt that they had a voice that was an important one to contribute to the conversation. And they were ready to be present to those conversations. And you know, that was a great source of inspiration and hope for me, and helped me to continue to keep my shoulder to that big stone that we try every day to push up the hill. So the people whose shoulders are next to you can be a great source of hope.
Let's see. Oliver, do you have a question?
I had one question, which was you talked about looking upstream, you know, babies being thrown in the water, going upstream and finding that some of this sat with kind of the executive, some of it sat with the legislative, locally and nationally. And I was wondering whether you ever considered in your own career, you know, you talked about the DC Housing Authority. Do you ever consider thinking, well, you know, Maybe I should try and work with the Housing Authority. What was your thinking about engaging in legislative or executive work yourself?
So it's interesting because I was talking to somebody about that very thing earlier today, a woman who was a mentee of mine at Georgetown, who is a legal services lawyer kind of through and through, but she's got this short-term gig working at the council and is trying to figure out, could she do that? And I do deeply believe that we need, you know, people with the hearts of, you know, an advocate working on the inside of government. I did not feel that it was a place that I could use my particular, you know, skill set. And as I reflect back on my life now, I think maybe I was a little bit too close-minded. I think that, and I was saying this to Lori this morning, that I think there is some value to the walk in my shoes, right? I think that the head of the Department of Human Services ought to sit at the front desk at the legal clinic and take the phone calls that our staff assistant would take and hear the terror in the voice of the mother who either has to go back to the place where she was, you know, abused, or sleep on the street with her kids tonight, you know. And that, I think that would impact some of the decisions that are being made. But at the same time, I probably would have had a greater understanding for the challenges that that head of DHS would have if I had to figure out how do I respond to this directive that's coming from my boss in the, you know, City Hall and the Wilson Building, and you know, do something that maybe I kind of think isn't the right thing to do, but I have to do it because otherwise I might get the axe. And if I get the axe, then who's nobody next? As good as me is going to come in here, right? That's probably part of their calculation. And you know, I would have benefited from understanding what some of those constraints and limitations are. And yeah, maybe in my next life I'll have a little more humility and realize that I should do something like that. I don't know.
It's challenging to be on both sides of these
things. It is. But there need to be good people inside of government. And I learned that because John's a good person and he used to be in the government.
Exactly. There you go. How about Ethan and Leo? Maybe we'll take our two final questions here.
Yeah, you mentioned earlier that, you know, the legal team is not working with a $2 million budget, and you know, homelessness is such an immense and sensitive issue. I was wondering how you sort of thought about prioritizing certain issues or certain cases or certain clients in light of a tight budget.
We turn to our North Star, and we find out what's important to our clients. And that's where we focused our resources. I know that sounds kind of simplistic, but that I think is such an important part of how you assess where you belong as an organization that has certain limitations. One thing I didn't say about the clinic that I think is worth mentioning is, and I assume this is still true, during my tenure at the clinic, we never took a dime of public funding. Right. We were fully privately funded.
It's still
funded. True. I would imagine. So I would have heard of someone's departure, I think, if it wasn't true. But it was an affirmative decision that the staff wished to make that the board ultimately supported. And it was hard because it's hard to raise money. And, you know, John knows,
sure,
right? He's
yeah.
been on, he's picked up that phone.
Yeah, no, sure.
And we lean on our board to raise money. And there's a lot of public funding for civil legal services in DC because of how effective the legal services community mm-hmm. has been in advocating for that funding. So there's almost easy money to be had, but the concern that we have always had was, at what cost does that money come? Like, what are the expectations? What are the constraints, real or perceived? And do we really feel like we can have the freedom to be responsive to whatever our clients ask of us if we have to in some way be beholden to the public fisc? And so the staff had made the recommendation that we forego public funding, and the board, I think, actually disagreed, but supported the staff, which I had the most amazing board, and you know, it's like to die for, to have a board that supports you when it's something so critical, and it's kind of an existential question for us at the clinic. And they knew it was going to make their lives harder to raise the money, but they trusted us. And I think we earned that trust.
Absolutely.
From over the years, for sure. But you know, we had a board that was very engaged in our work. Most of the board members had some history of either being a client of the clinic or a volunteer with the clinic, or you know, being engaged in some of the bigger advocacy projects that the clinic had taken on. So they were on that ground level, had seen that work, had made that connection, you know, that one-on-one connection, that building the relationship, that breaking down of otherness. And so the board believed in us and believed in, you know, the need to be able to be free from any constraints that might impact our ability to serve our clients. And so I've gotten a little off track of how we make those decisions, but I think that's just a really important piece of background. And yeah, going to the clients helped set the priorities.
Well, having worn both the volunteer hat and the board hat, I think people believed in you and the vision. And I do think, but I think it's, it's to your point, Ethan, it is a policy decision that affects your resource envelope.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's fair to say that we raise about as much money as you can, getting on the phone and sending emails to law firms in town. We can always do better, but it's, you have that resource, so then your budget envelope's limited, and then you have to trust Patty and the team, or now Amber and the
yes.
team, are consulting with clients to use whatever that envelope is as effectively as possible. So that's the
yeah.
sort of the two-step process. But those are policy constraints that the organization's yeah. taken on.
Because a lot of the advocacy that we've done over the years has been very fierce advocacy against the district government.
Yes,
and the district has tried in multiple ways to silence the legal clinic, and has not been effective in large measure because I have a board that supported us and was not, you know, bullied by, you know, an administration that called the board into a meeting to tell us that we were outliers and troublemakers and they should, you know, reel us back in. And the board said, I don't think so. No, you know. And if we had public funding, even though it gets administered through a private entity, if there was any way they could impact our funding, I have every confidence that they would have. You know, we had an intern call our office one time who said, I work in the general counsel's office at such and such agency, and I was given an assignment to find out what your sources of income are to see if there's any way that the government can control. And then she actually said that in a phone call.
But we've all gotten, so we got those phone calls when you get in trouble. No, absolutely.
Yeah.
Well, let me ask Leo for a final question, then we'll wrap up.
Since we're all Georgetown students here, so sorry. What was the most important thing that stuck with you from your time as an undergraduate here, and how was that equivalent here for you?
Well, this will take me back full circle to the beginning. I honestly think it was that opportunity to be a volunteer at Sursum Corda, that moment of seeing the contrast of what our family's reality was and what this incredible entity of the United States Congress. I mean, it's a government. I believed in our government. I believe in democracy, right? And you see this great symbol of our potential as a country and contrast that to the reality that's like barely a mile away. It was just so fundamentally wrong. And I do believe that, you know, maybe I didn't realize it at the time, but in reflecting back on it, I think that that was a pretty monumental, no pun intended, but pretty monumental thing for me that helped guide my path and my decisions.
I think that's an excellent place to come to an end, but I'd like to ask everybody to join me in a round of applause for Patty.